Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Welcome to our service of worship on this beautiful, beautiful morning. I was driving over and thinking there has to be a way that we all can get out there and sit out there. How many things would I have to bring? And I thought, well, the screen would be tough.
Just
myself.
Yeah, it'd be
fun. That's. Well, boy, this would be a day to do it. What a beautiful, beautiful day. Just a couple of announcements, and we'll do prayer requests a little later. please make sure to sign up for the luncheon after worship on October 17th. I know it seems like a long ways away, but this is the last Sunday in September. Does anyone know how that happened? Anyone? Like that, just went so fast. So please do sign up because we're going to be ordering stuff in for that, so we don't have to be trouble with the whole potluck and the issues around prepping food. So down in the kitchen, it'll be a good. We decide it's definitely going to be. It's going to be pizza. So, yeah. So you want to be here, and Sue Harry is great. So she's going to sign. She'll be sharing the pulpit and then a little bit more down there, and you can ask questions. Okay, those are mostly the. We are going to, and I have a little bit of an update on Macy, which I'll share, but they're going to try to do another get well basket for her. So you can put things in the hall marked for her, or Diane can probably give you some ideas. I know last time they also got some things. There's two other kids in the family, so they don't want it to be just like. Just for her. So if you need any hints or ideas about that, you can talk to Diane or certainly to Tina. Okay, let's have I love this song, What Faith Can Do by Cutlass. And we will take a minute.
Yes, it will take a minute. It's very slow today.
Yeah.
Everybody falls sometimes. Gotta find the strength to rise from the ashes and make a new beginning. Anyone can feel the ache. You think it's more than you can take, but you're stronger, stronger than you know. That's what faith is.
Lord, what faith can do. Not because of how we try to work up our faith, but that you give us faith and we place it in an object or a person in you, and you are completely capable. You are able to make miracles happen. You are able, and you do hear silent prayers as well as those aloud. You know what's going on in our hearts. You know our needs. You know who we are so much more than we even know ourselves. Lord, I pray that you would draw us deeper into faith in you, into knowing you, O God, into clinging to you, into recognizing your presence with us and within us. Lord, in this time, I pray that your Spirit would touch each one who is here at their point of need, whatever you desire to give to them. And I know that for each one, whether they're here or they're listening later with YouTube, Lord, you do have each one of us in your heart and mind and desire to speak to us and to move in our lives. Help us to open ourselves to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now we're going to have you do a little singing. And I said a while back we'd every once in a while do worship videos so we can get a little bit some of the contemporary music. And I made Diane really happy this week because Alita's away. And so she's filling in on the piano, and when I suggested we do some videos, she was very, very happy, and so I try to keep her happy. So we're going to sing a couple of songs with the video. Would you stand? If you don't know them, you will, or just enjoy them, or whatever.
Oh,
to sing to you.
Prayer requests. Joy gave me one before the service for her nephew, Tim, who has COVID. He's on a ventilator. He has several, he has some other issues that have made him, he's only in his 50s, but it's very serious, obviously. So please be praying for him and for his family. Macy did well this week. It says a little step back, but she has. They have to check her counts to make sure that she can have the treatments. Monday they'll test to check them, and hopefully get back on track. Prayer still very much needed. Last week, she really had almost, at one point, very almost terrifying kind of counts that were so low. But she is continuing in this intense month of treatments. Suzanne, she's having a bunch of tests before she can have her surgery. So pray for her and for Bert in the midst of it. Tina H. is having health issues. Pray for her. And this is, this was probably more a couple of things that are good things, exciting things. Fred and Nancy's grandson got married this week, so congratulations on that. Then yesterday was Ken and Anna's anniversary, and we were trying to figure out how many years, Ken?
57.
57 years. Well, God bless you guys, and I know it's, yeah, that's wonderful. Anybody else have a request or something you'd like to mention at this time? Yeah, Deanna.
John Cummings, high school teacher, has COVID and is in the ICU.
Okay, one of the teachers, John, it has COVID and is in ICU, so also very serious. Very serious issues. Anybody else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, I'm so grateful that we can come to you, that you always desire for us to come, even with some of these things that are so weighty and difficult, Lord, struggles that people have that we just don't know where it's going to end up, Lord, but we know you, and we know your love and grace, we know your power, and Lord, all those things that we heard and sang about this morning, none of these things negate those things. And in fact, we cling to you and your grace and your love and your power and your presence evermore when things are difficult. Lord, we pray for these folks who are ill, for John and Tim, who have COVID and are so seriously ill, and Lord, just countless others across our country and around our world. Lord God, I just pray that, I pray for healing for these folks that we know and your presence with them. But I pray as well for this crisis in our world, that you would be at work and that you would bring this plague really to an end. Bring it under some level of control at any rate, and just work in all of it as only you can do, Lord. We pray for Tina and for Suzanne, and of course for Macy, and pray, Lord, that as they go through their health struggles, that you would be bringing healing to them. We pray that Macy's counts would be coming up, and just continue to hold her up to you, Lord, as she continues this battle that she and her family have been fighting for months now. And Lord, I pray that they would know your strength. I pray that they would know your peace, Lord. The peace that we can have even when we don't know what the future holds. I pray that for them, Lord, and for each of us in whatever situations we face. Lord, we pray for Nancy and Fred's grandson and his marriage, and pray a blessing, and just be with them as they begin this new life together. And Lord, we're so grateful at the to have the testimony of Ken and Anna having been married 57 years. And Lord, I know that that's just a gift from you and an example of what true love really is. And I thank you so much for both of them, and be with them as well. Lord, be with our church and help us to be seeking you and seeking to know how best to walk in your ways and to serve you and love one another and our community and our world. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Now, I know that when there's, we haven't had a children's sermon in a very long time. And I know what most of you, it's the adults that really like them. The kids are doing this. Right? That's why they have the kids face the front when they do those things, because if they were facing you, they'd be like, So you're going to get an object lesson this morning. Jim saw this sticking out of the bag and said, did you wash that in hot water? I think it shrunk. Yeah, so now you probably all know what this is, a ukulele, for those of you outside. And it's considerably smaller than my guitar. But imagine for a minute that you had no idea what this was. How would you figure out what it's used for? Well, any ideas? No, we know what it is. So, well, if you want to know what it is and what it's used for, you'd probably kind of take a look at how it's constructed. If I were a caveman or woman, I might think it was a weapon, one good crack over the head. But frankly, it's kind of a lousy weapon because it's pretty fragile compared to, say, a rock, which would probably be better for the purpose. Maybe it's, there's a hole in here that's a little tricky to get into. Maybe it would trap small animals. And then you take the strings off, I guess, to get it out. I don't know. But again, it looks kind of really fancy for something to catch animals, and it probably wouldn't do real well outside. And then you think, well, these string things, they seem like they might be a pretty important part of things, because a lot of this has to do with the strings, right? You got this thing down here that they go over very carefully, and it's a two-part thing. You got these little windy things, and they go up, and little fretty things. And so maybe it has to do with, of course, it's not tuned very well, so you might not know. It's all right, huh? You think, well, that's not a bad. Maybe it's all about the sound, which doesn't seem. If I'm still a cave person, it wouldn't seem very. I can't eat it and I can't kill something with it. It might not be that appealing, but. By looking at it, I know that it was very carefully crafted. It's made for sound, but it's also just really beautiful. I mean, it could be painted some really ugly color, but instead it's got all these designs. And so that also tells me something about the Creator. What does it tell me about the Creator? Appreciates beauty. He went to all this trouble to make something beautiful, and frankly, it's the whole thing is not really pragmatic, is it? Art, beauty, music. The Creator cares about things like that. That doesn't mean he's not practical at all, but certainly means that's a part of it. And so, so I'd be real smart and I'd figure out a way to tune it. Maybe I'd even figure out a way to play it, which I haven't yet, so I'm just doing it. But But we'd figure out, maybe not what the, we wouldn't know what the name of it was necessarily, but we'd figure out what it's for by seeing what it does, looking at the characteristics. So we learn not only about the purpose of the thing, we learn something about the character of the creator. My cave person self might have some opinions about spending all this time custom crafting something just to produce music, but using that for pretty much anything else would be a useless and frustrating venture, right? Trying to use it for a purpose other than what it was made for is like the old adage, never teach a pig to sing. It wastes your time and it annoys the pig, right? So in examining the ukulele, I understand something about how it's made, the attention to detail, the great time and effort that went into it, the desire to make it beautiful as well as functional. And so I know that the creator places a high value on some kind of impractical things like music and beauty. And all those touches suggest that it was made with something like love, that whoever made it loved what they were doing and created it out of love. This morning we're going to be reading from a psalm that's probably very familiar to many of you, Psalm 139. We're actually going to just read from 1 through 16. I'm going to break it up a little bit as we go. And in this psalm, we hear David doing something like what we just did with the ukulele, except he's doing it with himself. He looks at himself and considers the way God has created him, and he's struck with awe and wonder and praise of God. This is a psalm, as I said, written by David, who probably had about the most intimate relationship with God other than Jesus himself. And so we can learn a lot about relating to God as we go through this psalm. So, Psalm 139, verse 1, we're going to start just going 1 through 6. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all of my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. So David is talking in these first verses about how intimately God knows him. We might say we know someone if we can put their name together with their face. We even, if you're on Facebook, you know, I've got friends that their name will come up and I'm going, who is that again? I don't know who that. But that's not the kind of knowledge God has. It isn't just like we're on a list. He knows everything about us. He knows our habits. He knows and understands our thoughts. I don't always understand my thoughts and my actions. He knows what we're going to say before we say it. You know, sometimes things pop out of my mouth and I think, oh, yikes, where did that come from? But God already knew I was going to say that. Sometimes I wish he'd put a hand over my mouth, but he doesn't always do that at the right times or the times I'd like him to. Warren Wiersbe talks about the fact that God knows us intimately, we cannot deceive him. The verb search, he talks about search me and know me, means to examine with pain and care. The Jewish people used this word to describe digging deep into a mine, exploring a land, and investigating a legal case. Our friends see the outside, but God sees the hearts. We cannot deceive it. We cannot deceive him. Adam and Eve tried to do it. Cain tried to do it. David even tried to do it later in his life. And all of them discovered it didn't really work that well to try to deceive God. And throughout this, there's a little bit of gratefulness and amazement at how God knows us, and a little bit of concern, or it can be a little disconcerting, right? To know that God knows us so well. And that has to do with kind of how we trust him. Several years ago, there was a song by a local folk singer when I lived up in New England, and it was about a couple who'd been married for a very long time. And it starts out with the words, "They seem to know each other very well, and they speak across the garden, though not a soul could tell." I love that. That picture of they've come to know each other so well that they barely need to use words to know what the other one is thinking. That's the way God knows us. Even when I'm silent, he knows what's on my heart. Sometimes I have to ask God to show me what's in my heart because he already knows. As I said, for some, the idea that God knows us so well can be kind of unnerving. We think that we may be able to cover up the bad parts and he might not notice. You know, I always kind of chuckle a lot of times when people who are like just really not church people meet me and find out that I'm a pastor. They kind of are like, "Oh no, I said a bad word in front of you." And it's like, I'm like, not anybody. If you don't, God is going to hear you and he's going to know whether you say it in front of me or not. But God knows all these things. Pastor Tim Keller says that to be loved but not known is comforting but superficial. Right? Someone who has warm feelings towards us but doesn't really know us. To be known and not loved is our greatest fear. To have somebody who doesn't care about us see what's really in there. But to be fully known and truly loved is a lot like being loved by God. It's what we need more than anything. It liberates us from pretense, humbles us out of our self-righteousness, and fortifies us for any difficulty life can throw at us. Because God knows us like no one else does, he loves us in a way no one else can. And he knows us because he wove us together, right? Created us. Verses 7 through 12, David goes on to talk about how God's presence is always with him. "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me and your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, 'Surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me,' even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you." As I said, for some people, the idea that God is always there and is always watching is not that comforting. Renowned atheist Christopher Hitchens, in a book titled God Is Not Great, which always kind of cracks me up. Here's somebody who claims to not believe in God, and he goes to the trouble of writing an entire book about the nature of the God in whom he does not believe. I think, huh. I mean, I don't think he wrote a book about elves or, you know, Santa Claus, but he wrote a book to disparage the character of a God he doesn't believe exists. But anyway, in his book, he wrote, "I think it would be rather awful if it was true that God exists, if there was a permanent, total, round-the-clock, divine supervision and invigilation, I had to look that up. It's like the proctoring of an exam, right? Somebody who's watching you when they're watching the exam. of everything you did. You would never have a waking or sleeping moment when you weren't being watched and controlled and supervised by some celestial entity from the moment of your conception to the moment of your death. It would be like living in North Korea. Come on, Chris, tell us what you really think, right? But why does he think that? He thinks that not because of the idea of God being always there, but because of what he thinks of who God is. I mean, the very title, God's Not Great. So he doesn't want this not great God that he doesn't believe in to be around all the time. You know, he pushes the idea of the biblical idea that God is always present to the idea that we are being controlled and supervised by God, which obviously we're not. I think if God controlled us, there'd probably be a lot fewer horrible things that happened, right? But what Satan is the one who controls, tries to control us. Think of in the creation when God says, don't eat from this one tree, and Satan rephrases it when he talks to Eve saying, did God really say you couldn't eat from any tree, right? He pushes the thing that God says, please don't do this, and he says, whoa, God won't let you do anything, will he? And twists it and makes it a worse idea of who God is. And that's exactly what Hitchens does there. Satan always starts with a little bit of truth and then twists it into something God never said. So with this passage, whether or not you see God's constant presence as comforting or frightening, or even as repugnant as Hitchens does, depends on how you see God. Is he a guy in a white lab coat and a clipboard watching you like a test rat? Or worse, trying to control you? No, he is the essence of love, walking with you in every circumstance and frankly, allowing you the freedom to do good things and terrible things. But he's with you. When I study for sermons, I try to use my very rudimentary language skills to make a rough translation, or at least get a better handle on some of the words that are used. Verse 11 and 12 in particular struck me as I did so. 11 says, surely, if I say surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me. It may sound a little like Hitchens trying to get out of the view of God, that the darkness will hide me from God's vision, right? But the meaning could also be something like this. If I say the darkness will crush me and the night is light for me, which makes more sense when followed by verse 12, even the darkness will not be dark to you. Right now, the darkness is seen as a crushing force, not something that'll hide us from this nosy lab coat God. But the darkness that could crush us is broken by his presence with us. Even the darkness, even the thing that could crush me, it's not darkness for you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. Gives it a different sense, doesn't it? Not that I'm trying to get away from God. Not that God is hunting me down. But that no matter how far it may seem I have gotten, God is already there. God doesn't just stay in churches and holy little places. He's in all the dark places. So that those who are in dark places can turn to him at any moment. And he's there. So God is with me in the darkest place. I can be assured that I will not be crushed because God is there and nothing is dark to him. And then verses 13 through 16. Well, first just 13 and 14. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. And literally, again, in verse 13, where it says, it's translated, you created my inmost being. Literally, it says, for you created my kidneys. Aren't you glad that God? All of you who are nurses are like, yes, I'm really glad that I have kidneys, especially if they're working well. It's less poetic, perhaps, than you created my inmost being. But for them, it meant the same thing. The organs, when they were sacrificing the kidneys, were the ones that were tough to get at. They're the deepest parts, the hidden parts. And so the Lord created those parts of us. They were seen as the seat of emotions and character and the will. And then verse 14, I praise you for I am distinguished by your marvelous deeds, is another way it could be translated. By your marvelous deeds and works, and my soul really knows that. We can praise God for how he has made us uniquely for his purposes. We think that being Christians is being like, oh, I'm nothing. With that amazing grace that saved a wretch like me. And so we think of ourselves as just wretches. Well, certainly we have been marred by sin. But Jesus reverses the curse, right? Lifts the curse from us. And so we are able again to reflect who God truly is and who God made us to be. I am fearfully and wonderfully made, and I tend to look at all the flaws I have, and I know them. I probably don't know all of them, but I have a long enough list, as we probably all do. But God, we have been created in such a way that we uniquely reflect the characteristics of God. It's almost like there's little pieces of God in each one of us. And nobody else reflects the Lord and who he is quite like you do. And so we can praise God for how he has made us uniquely for his purposes. And part of the way that we try to understand what God might be doing in us is, well, what are the things that I've done that have worked out really well? Or even reasonably well? What are the things I love to do? What are the things that God's put in my heart? We're known and loved and accepted by God. He is with us always and we uniquely reflect who he is. A couple of years ago, I was visiting at Freedom Village, and Maureen was there, and I assume they still do it this way. Then they clock in. There was a fingerprint scanner, so nobody can help you fudge your hours the way folks can with time cards. And you put your finger on the scanner, and when it's read your print, the screen says, you are accepted. And Maureen says, it's great. Some people wait their whole lives for that, and I know I'm accepted twice a day. I thought, what a wonderful reminder. That's a way to have, like, be listening for God, even in the mundaneness of every day. I'm accepted by God. We all need one of those, I think. God is the almighty weaver And he loves you. He wouldn't have made you if he didn't. I was saying last week, I was talking about how in the shack, the God figure always says, I'm particularly fond of that one. And this is why. He's particularly fond of each one because he has created those particularities and he loves them. He says, I did good work, man. This is good. Verses 15 and 16. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place, when I was woven together in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. God doesn't go to the trouble of handcrafting each person for nothing. When he wove you together, when he carefully chose every gene and every chromosome, when he placed in you characteristics that uniquely reflect his character, he did so with a purpose. And the first and most important purpose is to live in relationship with God. Before you do anything for him, it's to live in relationship with him, to allow him to share his glory through you. One of the early church fathers, Saint Irenaeus, said, the glory of God is a human being fully alive. When we fully are who God made us to be, God gets glory. The nature of things tells us its purpose. You need to know who you are and draw closer to God, and he will begin to reveal those certain aspects of the nature and glory of God. Because you were tailor-made to do that. And probably you're doing it without even being aware of it. God doesn't always tell us how he's using us in other people's lives, but he always is. The first gift God gives to us is ourselves, and the first gift he gives to us, to others through us, is who we are. Parker Palmer said, it can be a powerful experience to realize how much dormancy we contain, right? Things that are dormant, laying beneath the surface and ready to grow. If we're willing to drop that pretense and acknowledge that all that remains, and acknowledge all that remains unrealized in our lives, good things may happen. Palmer writes, especially for teachers, he's an educator himself, and he says, when teachers discover what is dormant in themselves, for example, they become more perceptive about what is dormant in their students and become better teachers as a result. People who've had a great teacher almost always say, they saw something in me that I never saw myself. And so it's good to take some time, as David did, to reflect and allow God to bring forth what's dormant in you. Maybe you think it's too late now, I'm too old for that stuff, but you're still breathing. God's not finished with you. There are still things that he wants to bring to light and life through you. Be that person who's fully alive, fully human, reflects the glory of God. Let's pray. Lord God, just work in and through us all that you have for us. Help us to value who you've made us to be, and Lord, to reflect you to others, to be fully alive, and show your glory to others. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, if you'd stand, and we're just going to sing one verse. Well, I guess there is only one verse, but something beautiful.
Beautiful, my heart.
the Lord's unfailing love rest upon us, even as we put our hope in him. God bless you. Go in peace.